Shabbat Shalom. These are intense weeks for our patriarch, Abraham. Last week, he had to get up, take his wife and his nephew, leave his home in order to follow God's voice to a place that God will show him. Last week, he tried to pass Sarai as his sister, and he experienced the Brit Ben Habitarim, the covenant between the pieces. This means that Abraham brought a three-year-old heifer, a three-year-old she-goat, a three-year-old ram, a turtle dove, and a young bird. He cut them in half. He placed each opposite the other, but he did not cut up the bird. When he fell asleep, we are told that God said to Abraham, spoke to Abraham, and renewed the covenant. There was even a smoking oven and a flaming torch that passed between the pieces. This certainly does not seem like an easy ceremony to affirm one's place in the covenant. Eliza, can you imagine if that's what you had to do to get ready for today? More than that, aren't we all glad that circumcision takes place only at 8 days? Not at 100 years, as we learned about in this week's Parsha. I'll say this again at Drew's bar mitzvah, but Drew was the first bris that I did here at the synagogue. And so how appropriate that the commandment to circumcise one's son comes in this week's Parsha. So the question is, after all that Abraham did last week, where he clearly showed his faith in God, why do we continue to have so many trials this week? Why, on the third day after recovering from the painful surgery of the circumcision, did Abraham greet guests at his tent? Why did Abraham accept God's sacrifice, God's commandment to sacrifice his son Isaac? Don't you think Abraham could have just taken a break? The rabbis explore the notion of all the tests that Abraham endured. They teach that there were in fact 10 tests in total, and they are his birth itself, being in prison for 10 years and being put in a furnace of fire, leaving his father's home, encountering a famine, having faith in Sarah that their relationship was still holy after he put her in a situation with Pharaoh, the battle of the kings, the Brit Ben Habitarim about which I just spoke, the covenant of circumcision, Abraham sending away his first son Ishmael, I spoke about that last evening, and the Akedah, the binding of Isaac. It is amazing to me that Abraham showed faith in God and acted out on this faith after sealing the covenant. So the question is, why was he tested at all, and certainly why over and over again? Many of the medieval biblical commentators were divided more or less along the lines of different approaches. Ibn Ezra maintained that God put Abraham to the test to see what extent he, in fact, was God-fearing, and he would then reward him for that. Nachmanides maintained that the trials were mostly for the benefit of the person tested. And Rashi and Radak were both of the opinion that the narrative of Abraham's trials were, in fact, for the world, both in the time of Abraham and in time and places like today that we might study and read, for us to be able to learn from those trials. So therefore, I would like to use this final understanding, the Rashi and Radak understanding, to show that there is something to teach us. And I'd like to explore how this can have an impact on our lives. We see from Abraham that the real tests happen after the ceremony, after the commitment. It's not just about the moment, it's about the commitments themselves. For example, when I work with couples in preparation for their wedding, I of course meet and talk about the logistics of the day. But I spend much more time talking with them about the days and the months after the wedding. What does it mean to be committed? What does it mean to have a Jewish home? What does it mean to be part of a couple? Marriage, as we know, is not always easy. Marriage is not only about standing under the chuppah and exchanging rings. Honeymoons are amazing, but marriage will not always be the honeymoon. There will be tests when we are asked to live up to the commitments that we made, and we need to be ready to pass those tests. So how do we do that? The thing about these tests is that it is hard when our relationships are tested by external force, and you might not even know you're being tested. If your coach is telling you you must be at practice, but you know that you've made a commitment to your religious education, or you should follow your rules, but your friend's parents might have different rules, how do you behave? How do you stand up for somebody who's getting picked on if you are not getting picked on? And if you stand up for them, you might get picked on as well. How do we live up to the commitments that we have made to those dearest to us? Dr. Gabi Barzilai from Bar-Ilan teaches that the need to choose between conflicting values is one of the characteristics of Abraham's trials. It is not so hard to do the right thing when it's perfectly clear what is right and what is wrong. The true trial lies in deciding between two values, which are both important, which are both right, when there is no way to uphold both simultaneously. The question is how to make decisions in those moments. You know, you won't always know that you are being tested until it's over. You might not always succeed. You might make the right decision for a given moment. You might make a different decision at a different time. But the idea is to keep trying. Unfortunately, in today's polarized society, we are often asked to look at things through only one lens, without realizing that tests aren't easy, but it's how we respond are important. Our immediate gut reaction might not be the right thing. We might not know the right answer. We need to be okay in our humility to say, I'm not sure. We do the best we can with the information at hand. But we need to succeed in living up to the commitments that we make. And that starts with having a strong foundation. We need to be proud of those commitments. We need to be proud of the relationships. We need caring and supportive people to help us understand why these are important. And we need to be able and ready to seize the opportunity to recognize and to pass tests and to be heroic in our own ways. For Eliza, today is her bat mitzvah, but the tests come tomorrow and next week and the weeks after that. She has entered the phase of becoming bat mitzvah, but this is a moment of transition, not a moment of conclusion. Just as a graduation is called a commencement, a beginning, Eliza, I hope that this is the beginning of how you embrace what it means to be a member of the adult Jewish community and still a kid at home. I hope that you will embrace Nisiyah, our journey for our teens. Just like Abraham journeyed, I hope you will journey with us. I know that you come to this moment with a strong foundation from your family and this community, but now you are a part of the decision-making process, and I hope that you choose Jewish. For as Abraham showed us, choosing Jewish isn't only about standing up for the Jewish people or even God. It's about being a forceful advocate for justice in our world. And so, Eliza, it will be up to you to seize opportunities in front of you to be heroic, to be a model. You have already shared your Torah with us today. That is step one. You have inspired us to think about ourselves as advocates. That is step two. Now, all of us need to understand what is worth fighting for and take that next step like Abraham did, to make the right choices, even at difficult moments. Shabbat Shalom.